Hi all, I'm Vijay, Faculty of Psychology from Shankar IAS Academy. So today we are going to discuss about the psychological impacts of COVID-19. So we all know that this COVID-19 started in China in a seafood market, and slowly it got turned into an epidemic in Wuhan region. And because of the global connectedness, it has turned into a pandemic where more than 150 countries have got affected. So now, we have seen a lot of epidemics and pandemics, for example, like the Ebola, the SARS-1, the version 1, MERS, and Nipah. But actually, what this coronavirus differs, its ability to spread rapidly and effortlessly. That is the reason today we find that more than 200 countries have got affected, and nearing around approximately, they say that 2 crore population have got infected and 7 lakh death has happened. In India alone, we find that nearing around 40,000 death and more than 21 lakh has got affected, and every day we find a rise of around 20,000 cases, infected cases. So that's how the power of the coronavirus, which has the virulence factor, which has a high spread rate. So coming to the government, yes, almost 140 days back, the government has taken some series of measures. We know that we started with a nationwide lockdown, and the government took some measures like quarantine, and the government has taken something like contact tracing and building the health infrastructure, providing the support for the poor people and migrants and so on. But actually, what the government has missed is the mental health. So why I need to specifically talk about the mental health or psychological health is, in China, they did a survey during the SARS. They found that in the survey population sample, out of this sample or out of this population, 53% of the respondent told that they had experienced some sort of psychological symptoms. And nearing 16% of the population has got some depressive symptoms, and around 28% of the population has got some anxiety symptom. So it clearly shows that the pandemic or in some sort of epidemic has some problem on the mental health or the psychological health. So we need to focus on the mental health. Now, the second thing is, today many healthy individual has also started experiencing some psychological symptoms. Now, these healthy people, individual, they are not much aware of it, that they are experiencing the psychological symptoms, or sometimes even they are very aware of it because of the guilt, shame, or because of the embarrassment, they are unlikely to take medical help, and most of the time they suffer in the silence. So that's the reason we have to focus more on the psychological health and mental health during this pandemic period. Because anyway, at one point of time, we are going to find some medicines or vaccine to control this virus, coronavirus. But the thing is, the medical crisis may end, but the psychological crisis, the mental health crisis may begin. So that's the reason our focus has to be more, or our focus and even the government focus has to be more on the mental health. Now, this entire pandemic, this coronavirus, ultimately induces stress on the people. So I will say that there are 4 sources of stress during this pandemic. The first thing is the nature of the virus. Now, initially it was said that the WHO said this virus does not transmit from people to people, but later they said that yes, it can spread from people to people, it is a contagious, and later whether it transmits in the air, whether it does not transmit in the air. So we have a lot of confusion over this virus, how this virus will behave. Even though today we have some reasonable information, but yet we have to get the complete information about the virus. The second is the long period of economic instability. We know that all the community services has been closed down, the business has been collapsed, and all the education institution, colleges, competitive exams, everything has been altered. So that is a second source of thing, and many people are in the confusion, what about the future of economic future in India? The third thing is the extensive media coverage. Now, the media coverage, if you take a media, the job of the media is to give preventive and precautionary. But what happens, you see, some of the media content directly or indirectly creates some apprehension and also creates some sort of amplification among the people. So that is the third source of stress. And the last one is the information about when this crisis is going to end. Now, that's a loss of confusion. So still now, we are not very clear. Even the president of the United States said that it is the virus has to decide. Even in India also the same case, we don't have information. Now this four sources is creating a lot of stress among the people. For the people who are in the business, for the people who are working the job, or the people who are preparing for competitive exams and schools, colleges, for everyone this is a source of stress. Now I'm going to discuss briefly, because of the brevity of the time, what are all the psychological changes that happens in the various, in the people of the various stakeholders, like the general public, for the medical professional, for children's and etc. And then what are all the psychological symptoms people will experience during this pandemic period, and intervention, how we need to intervene. So in this, the first one is what are the behavioral changes or the psychological changes we are going to experience. The first one, coming to the general public. Now, by and large, we find that today many people, regardless of the exposure to the virus, they are in the constant fear and anxiety. Now, that is nothing but because of the information about the virus. And what happens, you see, people are in constant fear, and the very vulnerable group is the people who have this pre-existing disease, like diabetes or hypertension or heart disease and all. What happens, you see, they become very hyper-vigilant to any symptoms. For example, a small cough comes, a small rise in temperature in the body. Immediately, they overreact that they think that they get infected or they will pass the infection and so on. So that means, by and large, today, most of the people during the pandemic, even in India, they are in a constant fear and anxiety. The second thing is community-level distrust. Now, what is that community-level distrust I mean? Even though we have to maintain social distance, which the government advises and everything, by and large, when we go and interact with the people, we always maintain some sort of a distance. It's not only for the cautious, it's something I will say it's because of the suspicion. That means the trust level comes down. It happens within the relatives, it happens within the family also. So the trust comes down, the suspicious level, it increases. It's a second behavioral change we find it. The third one, it's blaming of people who got ill. Now, normally you know that during any disaster, or if you find anyone has got some problem, health related problem like cancer or something, most of the time we we find some empathy, we find some sympathy towards a person. And even during the natural disasters and all, there are many altruistic people who go help and the people who got affected by the disasters. But today, when we get an information that one is getting infected because of the coronavirus, we start, or people tend to blame the people, they think that it is because of the irresponsibility they got the infection. That means the empathy level or the altruism and the sympathy level is reducing. That's the third behavioral change we find in this. The fourth one is people are trying to seek inappropriate health seeking behavior. Today we find that people are trying some sort of unproven methods or remedies for this coronavirus, and also there is many marketing. We can find the product has got some boosting the immune system. Okay, it is working against the coronavirus. Now these products, we really do not know whether it has got some scientific evidence or something, but even though it does not have any impact on our body, people are trying to seek these health seeking behavior because of the anxiety over this coronavirus. And sometimes these alternate, whatever may be, the people trying it, it can also be detriment to their health. And it is also waste of time, waste of money and energy. That's another health-seeking behavior is a unnecessary, or I will say inappropriate health-seeking behavior is another problem we find. And the next one is the hoarding behavior. So it is common that the common public always think that because of the pandemic, there may be a shortage in the supply chain. So they buy, purchase everything, they hoard it. But the concern here is the exploitative businessman. Now this exploitative businessman, what they try to do is they hoard a lot of products, they create demand in the market, and finally they sell it in a very high price in order to make money during this, during the COVID period. So these are some of the behavioral changes we find in the people. And apart from this, xenophobic attack, which we have seen in some parts of North India. So mistakenly some people have attacked some of our Northeast brothers, thinking that they are Chinese people. So it's something comes in there. So now you can see these are the psychological changes, that behavioral changes comes among the general public. Now coming to the second one, the medical professional or medicos. So medical professional includes the doctors, the nurses and all other who works in the healthcare or any healthcare workers. Now we know that they are the four front warriors of this coronavirus, because they are the one who directly works with the coronavirus patient. Now, normally, it is something a high risk work because they have the high risk of exposure. And also the medical field is a one which is a high demanding work because it's more stressful. If a doctor goes here for the 12 hours of time, he has to constantly work with the patients and everything, and he has to have the mask and everything. He cannot maintain much social distance and all. That means they have the high level or high risk of getting exposed to the virus. Now, what happens to the doctor? Normally, doctor, generally, they know the level of risk. So the doctor also takes a risk. Of course, the doctor has to take a reasonable level of risk in order to, of course, they have to save themselves also. Now here, many doctors or the healthcare professional get into some sort of a conflict. Normally, we call it as a cognitive dissonance. The reason is the doctor has to save a patient because it is his professional ethics. So one side comes the professional ethics. The second, many doctors also have an altruistic tendency. They also kind-hearted, they want to help the patient or something. So altruism comes in the second end. And at the same time, the doctor also has a personal fear. Most of the time, the doctor, even sometime, the doctor may not even fear about their own life, but they fear about their loved ones and the children. Suppose if the doctor is getting infected, probably the doctor may pass the infection to the their children and the loved ones. Now, you can see the three, the triangle, the three corners of the triangle. The one is the professional ethics, the one is the altruism, the third one is the personal fear. Now, most of the time, the doctor and the healthcare workers gets into the conflict in this triangle, the three parts of the triangle. So that is another one which is happening to the doctor. That means the doctor are the one who are going to experience high emotionality, high stress, and there are more chances that the doctors may also get into some psychological problem like PTSD, which is called post-traumatic stress disorder. Then the next stakeholder, then the major behavioral change where we can find it in the children's. Normally, we know that children's are very active and children's, they want to be very playful and they want to be with their peer group. Most of the time when they are separated from the peer group, they find some sort of a separation and they find some sort of a boredom and loneliness. Now, this boredom and loneliness changes their behavioral pattern. For example, their routine schedule changes, they go for a long sleeping hours, and probably if there is no proper intervention with them, if the parents are not engaging with the children, normally they spend most of their time in their mobile gadgets, in videos and other inappropriate medias, that will totally change the psychological health of the children's. So that's what for the children's also, it is going to have a big impact apart from the medicals and the general people. And the next one is the affected people. When coming to the affected people, I can divide the affected people into two types. One is affected by the coronavirus. You know that once when one is affected by the coronavirus, the government takes them to a quarantine. In a quarantine, probably they may be there for 20 days or 21 days, something like that, 14 days to 21 days, something. But actually, many people think that quarantine will not have an impact, but quarantine is the one which is going to have the maximum impact. Because the same in the SARS-1 period, in China, they have done a study. In the study, people who got into quarantine, when they are in the quarantine for more than 10 days, they are likely to experience this post-traumatic stress disorder. It's nothing but anxiety and depression. And also, they found that after the people come from the quarantine, even they recover from the coronavirus, after 3 years, after the recovery period also, many quarantine people are poor in reporting work and they have got high alcohol abuse. And also, they more than 20% to 25%, they found that people, the quarantine people or the affected people, avoid crowded places and public places. So it clearly shows that the psychological impact, even after the SARS, even after the coronavirus, even after the quarantine period, is also very long. So that's the reason we need to properly intervene the quarantine people. So there should be a constant psychological help for the quarantine people. Then coming to the affected people, the second type of affected people, probably they, I will say that they may not get affected. Probably their loved ones or their family members got affected, or probably they would have expired or dead or something. Now, in this case, these people, apart from depression, they will also experience a lot of anger and irritation. Now, this anger or this sort of anger or whatever may be, It will be directed towards the healthcare or directed towards the government and directed towards the common public. So they are also the one who is going to get most affected. Now, this is what the, in brief, the major psychological changes we find among the various people. Now, I want to get into the next topic, next part of the topic. What psychological symptoms generally people will experience during this pandemic period? Or let me put it in another way. If you want to know whether I'm in a good mental health during this psychological, or sorry, during this pandemic period, so whether my quality of life is good, whether I'm in a good mental health, now there are some indicators. Now I'm going to talk about some of the symptoms which the people is going to experience during this pandemic period when they experience high level of stress. So the first and foremost is the insomnia. There is a lack of sleep. Now, normally insomnia, for some people, even before the coronavirus, they may have an insomnia problem, exempting them. During this corona period, after this pandemic, if one gets an insomnia, lack of sleep. So when I say lack of sleep, it can manifest in different form. The first one is the onset of the sleep. For example, you go to the bed by 11 o'clock. So sometimes it may take 15 minutes to get into sleep, or sometimes it may take even sometimes 30 minutes or 1 hour. But 3 hours or 4 hours. For example, you go to the bed at 11 o'clock, but you're not getting a sleep up till 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock, then the person is suffering from an insomnia. That is the lack of sleep. Or the second form, probably they may get into a sleep, but early morning wake up, like 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock, okay, early morning wake up with a bad dream or something. And then after 2 o'clock, they wake up, and then again they go for a sleep, they may not get a sleep till in the morning. Now, this is the first symptom, which is, I will say, insomnia. So, which is not a healthy symptom. The second symptom is the boredom and loneliness. Yes, quite everyone in our point of life, we will experience boredom and loneliness. The question is how long and how intense. If you're experiencing more boredom and loneliness throughout the day, then that is also not a right sign. The third one is the obsession. See, obsession means putting the same thought again and again. If one is getting a same thought, like fear of getting infected, for this they get into unnecessarily go and wash their hands. For example, yes, the government advises frequent hand washing, the medicos advises. But the thing is, if you're not going outside, if you're not in contact with any products, or if you're not in contact with an outsiders, then there is no unnecessarily to wash for every 20 minutes or 30 minutes. Then if something comes like an obsessive compulsive. Okay, that is a disorder which is called obsessive compulsive disorder. So there should be a reasonable amount of hand washing, reasonable amount of taking a hygiene one. So if one constantly gets a thought that they will get infected, and because of that they have some compulsive behavior, then that is a third symptom, which I can call it as obsessive compulsive or obsessive symptom. The fourth one is the anxiousness. So anxiousness, sometimes it comes in the heart palpitation, okay, like you say, the sweating and also the tremors and uncomfortableness, irritation. So that's a third symptom. That's the next symptom we need to look for. The next symptom is the depressive symptom. So depressive symptom, there can be many depressive symptoms, but the very important is when you wake up in the early morning, you should have a good mood. Suppose when people wake up in the early morning with a low mood, okay, after that, what I'm going to do? What is the purpose? What's the purpose of living? Such a thought or some suicidal thought comes, then that comes the depressive symptom. And the next one is very important, self-blame and rumination. Suppose before this corona period, you would have taken some decision. Probably it may have some repercussion or it may have some consequences during this corona period. Any decision you would have taken before a corona period, and that effect you may find during this pandemic time. Yes, it was taken, it is a past. But unnecessarily taking that past and ruminating, brooding yourself is something which we call it as a self-blame and rumination, which is also totally wrong. Reasonable level we can have, but we cannot have it for a long period of time. And then comes the next one is a somatic problem. Somatic, soma means it's a body. Unnecessary body pain without any reasonable physiological problems is also a symptom. Now, these are all the brief symptoms which can experience. But I want you to be very careful. Some sort of the symptoms many people will experience during this pandemic period. So if you're experiencing this, don't brand yourself you've got into anxiety or depression, because you need to see what is the intensity, and also because the psychological problem is something like a continuum, that is low to high. So sometimes we may in low, sometimes we may go to high, again we may come to the low, because it's a mood is something fluctuating. So that is what the best indicator is, whether it is affecting our day-to-day life. That means your social functioning and occupational functioning has to be good. If your social functioning and occupational functioning is not good, you feel a lot of distress with yourself, you're not concentrating on your studies, then really we need to go for some sort of a medical help. For most of the time, talk therapy itself will be a good thing. Only in a severe cases, we need to go for some psychological intervention. So this is the one set of behavior. The second set of behavior, the second set of psychological symptom, which is a little bit severe, is a maladaptive behavior. When come to maladaptive behavior, people during this pandemic period enter into extreme irritation and anger. Now this anger manifests in aggression or also sometimes in form of a violence. That is what you can see a person, even in the news it came, a quarantine person has killed an old lady, and also a lot of domestic violence. This and all during the pandemic period, it's a maladaptive, it's not right. And also fighting with the police. Actually it's not normal. So a normal man should understand this is a pandemic, so we need to follow the rules, we need to follow, unnecessarily we should not go out. And if you are losing your emotion because of the irritation, probably people go fight with other. So that all the aggressions and violence happens during this. And apart from the domestic violence, and the very important is the alcohol abuse. And this we can find in many people during this pandemic period. So they consume a lot of alcohol beyond their limits. Whatever they have taken before their pandemic period. And apart from that, they go for some recreational drugs. And even if a person is going for a non-prescriptive sleep aid, something for the sleep, it is also not a right behavior. So these comes under the all your tobacco, and also tobacco, taking tobacco, smoking, everything comes under the maladaptive behavior. Now, these are the symptoms many people will experience during this pandemic period, and especially during this lockdown. Okay, now, as I told earlier, these symptoms, when people experience beyond a limit, they may enter into anxiety, depression, which is a clinical anxiety, which is a clinical depression, and also PTSD, which is a post-traumatic stress disorder. Now, the question is how we need to intervene. Yes, suppose by and large, if you are experiencing any of the symptom, a mild symptoms, you need not much bother about it. Okay, we need to take some actions. So, okay, what we can do, and also what the government has to do. So first, coming to the intervention, I will say that first and foremost, we should not indulge in any or indulge or entertain any false information or rumors. That's the first thing. When you come across any false information, rumors or something, immediately we should not react. Actually, we should respond. So we should not much entertain this information. We should have some good source information, selected information, and also information we need to keep it at the reasonable level or minimum level. That's the first thing. Unnecessarily going and browsing all the information related to coronavirus, unnecessarily getting panic, there is no use at all. So that's the first thing we need to take care. The second is scheduling, the scheduling in our life. So we need to maintain a schedule for a day. For example, tomorrow morning wake up, so 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock I'm going to wake up. So what is my schedule for the day? So that schedule should be a holistic one. So what the schedule should have is, probably if you're a IAS aspirant studies, okay, what is your study time? So what is your TV time? So you should also have a time for games or activities or something. And also very important, you should have also some time for family activities. So scheduling the time, making a schedule for a week or for a month, and following that routine will make you a better person, and also will also prevent you from some psychological distress. And also we need to try out some new things, some develop some hobbies during this period. This is an opportunity, because it's a lockdown, we are going to be in the house. And the next one is socializing. Socializing, right now we cannot have a direct contact because of the infection and everything. So we can socialize through phone and social media, but be careful. We should not spend much time. So in your schedule or in your schedule, you should have a time, a particular time for a phone or WhatsApp or something. And second thing is, if you are likely to experience stress, don't get into much argument, some sort of a political argument into the thing, because that will further magnify your stress. Normally try to see some happy news or try to get some good information so that the knowledge can be cultivated. That's another thing we can do. And very important, avoid any type of a drugs, alcohol or any type of a drugs, we need to avoid. And the next very important thing is we need to stop this risk-taking behavior. Because of the boredom and loneliness, many people, what they do is they go out, they meet. Actually, this is something risk-taking behavior. So now we should know how to manage our boredom and loneliness within the house or within wherever we are. So unnecessarily risk-taking behavior is something which will create problem for us. At the same time, it will also create problem for the others and the family members, the old age people and everything. And social isolation should be never. So whether we are an introvert or extrovert does not matter. In this time, pandemic time, we should try to socialize. We should try to mingle with the people through social media or through phones or through. And very important, we should always talk with the positive people. And don't try to get negative information. When people sometimes give negative information or negative vibration, please don't take it, because that will affect our psychological health. Always talk with the positive person, positive people, and also the positive information. And people who are working in a corporates, we need to avoid the long working hours. Today the corporate, what happens, you see their routine schedule also changes. Many corporate employee, they wake up very late by 10:30 and they start their phone calls and they start their video calls and everything. They don't have a proper break time, they don't have a proper lunch time, and evening time even till 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock they go for a calls. Actually, this is totally wrong. So the HR of the companies or HR of the corporate should schedule. So they should have a time, like morning 10 o'clock it has to start, some around 11:30 to 11:45 there should be a break. So during the break time, or 1 to 2 o'clock lunch break, during the break time there should not be any phone calls. Mandatorily they need to make it as a policy. And evening 7 o'clock or whatever the timing, they need to have a schedule. So beyond that time, no employee should work. At the same time, within the time, all the meetings or any work has to be scheduled and thing. Now, beyond this, if one is getting a problem, they should not suffer in silence. They should seek help without any hesitation. They can talk with some known peoples. Only if they have a severe symptom, they can go for some psychological intervention. When we go for psychological intervention, so today we have a wonderful psychological techniques like cognitive behavioral therapy, stress management therapy and all, behavior modification therapy. So now probably you may study, you may be in the preparation. So that time you may not focus on the preparation. So what you need is a behavioral modification. So we have many psychological methods because during the lockdown period, we can schedule it flexibly. We can have a teleconsultation. So they can do a teleconsultation. So now there are many methods to counter this problems. So in general, the individual should take some sort of intervention in order to be mentally healthy or in order to have a good quality of life during this pandemic period. Now, coming to the government has got a lot of responsibility. We always, generally, there is a word that information is key. Now, the government should try to give some unified public message, because the various studies have shown that, especially during the pandemic or epidemic, when there is a higher satisfaction with the information, it has highly correlated with the lower psychological distress. So that means when people get information, a unified information, the right information during the pandemic period, most of the time the psychological distress will be comparatively very, very less. So that's what the government should try to give, better information and unified public message. And the government should also try to control all the rumors and everything. So periodically, best information or good information has to be given to the public. The second thing is prediction of likelihood when this coronavirus or pandemic is going to end. Of course, it's very difficult. As everyone says, it's a virus has to decide when it is going to end. But we have many mathematical modeling, we have some wisdom, we have knowledge. Based on this, if the government can try to bring out some prediction, for example, this pandemic is going to end by next 3 months of time. So that was the course of action. Suppose if it is not going to end by 3 months of time, if it's going to end by another 6 months of time, what is the course of action? How we need to get prepared? How the government will get prepared? How the public has to get prepared? How the competitive exams or any competitive exams or anything education institution can be prepared? So if the government brings out some plan, even though it may have some political issues, if the government are able to bring this type of a plan, this information can make or can bring less psychological distress to the people. That's the second thing the government has to focus. The third thing, which everyone knows, economic revival. So the government has to work out, the government already has prescribed some, given us some fiscal stimulus and everything. So apart from that, giving impetus to the business houses, industries and businessmen and also individuals in the taxation also can give some relief to the people. And very important, the government has a high responsibility in protecting the high risk groups, especially the medical professionals and also the healthcare workers and police and even the police and defense. So they are the high risk group which the government has to take more intervention. And very important, the government has to bring mental health policies, especially for the quarantine people, and also the government has to identify who are all the vulnerable group, and accordingly the health policy and the psychological intervention through teleconsulting has to be given. Apart from this, the government can use all the artificial intelligence and smart technologies and everything. So now this is how the government can intervene, the individual can intervene. So as I said, this coronavirus does not or didn't respect any borders. So it has crossed more than 200 plus countries. Now everyone is suffering. The thing is, we need to maintain a proper psychological health. That is a very important task. Now we know that we are in uncertainty, but we have to be very certain in our schedule, in our ways, in our routines and everything. Whatever the uncertainty, definitely this coronavirus will have some sort of psychological ramifications or psychological consequences in the people, which is going to be long lasting, because all the studies in the China during the SARS-1 period has told, in fact, I discussed about the quarantine and everything. So that is what the government has to give more focus on the health policies and everything, and also has to be very careful in maintaining this mental health and mental health problems. And strategically, we should have a psychological defense, and so that the nation can work and defend this long lasting coronavirus and secure success and lead a quality and good standard of living and also a happy life. Thank you.